Hello everybody and welcome to a new episode of Call the Experts by Bosch Rexroth. My name is Robert Weber and I'm sitting next to Jörg Heckel and Christopher Palitz in a huge conference room in Germany and some thousand kilometers east in Shanghai. Hua Jin Yu is on the other side of the line and we will talk about the intralogistics market in China and Europe and of course about your new innovation, the Locator. Gentlemen, please introduce yourself.
Yes, hello, my name is Christopher Palitz, and I've been a roboticist for, well, I have to say, nearly 20 years now, and I'm responsible here for the development, testing, and support of our software components for mobile robots like the Locator.
Jörg Heckel?
Yes, hello. I'm a computer scientist and in automation business since 2000 and for industrial applications since 2013. And I'm the project director here at Bosch Rexroth for the robotics topic.
Hua Jin?
Hi, everybody. My name is Hua Jin Yu. I have a technical background in signal processing and I've been with Bosch Group in China for more than 6 years. I was previously with the corporate research in Asia Pacific, majorly responsible for industry robotics and also in industry 4.0. I'm now with Bosch headquarters in China for product area new business. And our major focus here in China is clearly to support our colleagues from Germany to explore the Chinese market for mobile robotics components.
Okay, thank you very much. Before we start, I have some technical advices. We are recording this podcast. So for this reason, you are all muted. You can ask your questions in the chat room. And if you have any other questions, you can write an email to robotics@boschrexroth.de. And after the, if you have a very important question after this podcast, you can write in the chat and say, hey, I need a call now. And then we will unmute you after this podcast and you can talk with the experts. So, I see two smiling faces, but I think Hua Jin is also smiling because your team won the IFOI award. This is a intralogistics award in Germany, Europe, worldwide. So are you surprised that you won this, Jörg?
Yes, a little bit. It's our first time we participated in this event and award. And to win at the first time is really special. It was a great experience.
Okay. So and there was a jury from tech magazine journalists, and they checked your software or your idea or what was the idea?
Journalists and then also from institutes, the scientists that are very competent in this field, and they checked in advance, and then we had a few days in Hanover to present our product, and also to answer questions and get tested.
Okay. So congratulations from my side. Now the party is over, and we have to think about what's coming next. For your branch, for the economy, and I'm very happy that we have a colleague from China with us today. And my first question is to China, to Shanghai. Today I heard in the radio that the economy is growing again in China. How is the situation in the intralogistics market in the moment, Hua Jin?
Yes, we had the impact of coronavirus in the beginning of this year, but may you have already heard here in also in the in Europe that Chinese market is now booming again. We are ramping up already since April, and now the demand for the industry is now increasing dramatically. And already this trend actually for the modernizations of the industry sectors is already one of the focus of the government. That's why the long trend is also now the short term. The plus of the ramp up is always pushing up for the intralogistics market in China overall.
China is a huge country and has a lot of space. In Europe, we have not so much space, and for this, we have many automated warehouses. Are Chinese companies also interested in more automation technology, Hua Jin?
Yes, due to several factors. I think China now is not anymore a developing country. I would not say we are already a developed country, but we also have some similar factors which we can share with you. For example, we also have the problem of the increasing wages for the menu operators. And also, we have another benefit is that in China, we have a lot of booming e-commerce businesses. And this then really has a high demand for fully automatic warehouses. And on the other side, due to the government push, for example, the policy of Made in China 2025, robotics is definitely a key factor which will be on the list of our central government policy and financial support.
Jörg, AGVs, this is a big market for AGVs, I think, in China. In Germany, we have very fixed installed warehouses a lot, but the customers don't want that anymore in some reasons because it's not flexible enough. But when I started in this branch, it was 10 or 15 years ago, we already talked about AGVs, but nothing happened. Why now? Why is it, why we have a coming back of AGVs?
Because the technology has improved. We have more calculation power, we have better sensors, we have a stronger competition in these components. Like Virgin said, also a huge demand in the market, not only in Asia, but also in Europe. And I think this year will be another push when returns come back and money will be available.
I think money is not the problem in the moment. Yes. It's a lot of money.
That's also our goal, to improve the situation, to cope with this demand and provide flexible and easy to use components to be able to do more AGE projects and more automation projects in a shorter time.
Mm-hmm. Eugene, we know a lot of AGVs builders in Europe. Can you name some Chinese companies working on AGVs?
Yes, I think we can name one. You may know that already. It's called GIP Plus. And GIP Plus is one of these startup customers we are engaging now in China. Now we have a deep cooperation with them, and now we are working with them in different market sectors, actually, not only in China. We are also cooperating with them in several others. So this could be one name we can name.
So, and are there other companies investing in AGVs?
Yes, they are big state-owned companies, for example, for forklifts. Basically, they are traditional forklifts builders, OEMs, but they are also investing in some spin-off of their, let's say, big state groups to have some innovative forklifts solutions. But they are also, money is also not a problem in China, right? So we also have a lot of venture capitals, private equity investors, let's say these financial institutions. They are also now investing a lot in the sectors of intralogistics. And that's all the, let's say, the financial support, the benefits for our potential customers, for example, startups and also established autonomous forklifts and robotics OEMs.
Okay. Why do you think it's so trendy or so sexy to invest in AGVs?
For one side, it's innovative approaches. As Jörg already said, in the recent years, the algorithms, the technology is improving. Second, of course, for financial investors, clearly we have a big return of investment. This is not only for the other customers, but also for the AGV OEMs. And for a third part, I think also this matches to the general government push from the central government. In China, the Internet Plus, it's a general definition, meaning intelligent and efficient. So that's all these environments, factors gives the very nice ecosystems, also the general setups.
Okay. Jörg, today we want to speak also about the Locator.
Yes.
Bosch Rexroth is also building an AGV, but now today we are focused on the Locator. This is a software product from Bosch Rexroth, correct?
Yes, correct.
What is the locator and for what do I need the locator in an AGV?
The main part to start with when you enter a new site with an AGV is to teach the AGV where it is, the position. The GPS doesn't work in that environment because usually it's covered with the roof. So our software, it's also called the Laser Slam, establish and a map and creates a map of this environment and gives the AGVs the position. Position, orientation, and this is a very easy and flexible way.
So I don't order an AGV for you, I order only this software package.
Yes, correct.
And do I order the laser scanner or only the software?
Yes, we provide only software because usually the our customers, the AGV or AMR OEMs, they already have hardware. They have chosen an ECU, an industrial PC for their application that fits into their space on the AGV and the space requirements, energy requirements, and so on. And that's why we decided to encapsulate this software, be able to run on almost any type of hardware and be very flexible.
Christopher, this is your part. How you implement the software on the control unit at the AGV? How do you do that? With a traditional API or what is it?
So we deliver our software in a Docker, which is a virtualization package, which allows basically our software to run on all sorts of different operating systems and different kinds of hardware. And then there is actually an API, which you can use to integrate the locator into your own software. But we also offer a graphical user interface as a standalone component, especially for the first tryouts and experiments. So you can really very quickly start to get to know the locator and see if it's suitable for your application.
You mentioned this graphical topic. Do I need to take it or can I use my own?
Yes, so as I say, it's a standalone component, just the user interface as a standalone component, separate piece of software that can also run on a separate machine. And you can basically copy it if you like. If you, for instance, build your own AGV, you might have your own user interface where you need to configure the vehicle, where you can set, you know, the routing and really configure your vehicle. You might want the localization to be a piece of your own interface, and then you can just use our own API to sort of develop your own user interface to control our software as well.
But the idea is that they take your user interface. Because you invested a lot of time in user experience, I think.
The user experience, our user interface is more or less an example of how you can use our localization system. That's really the idea. It's just a showcase. And of course, the user experiments and everything went into the user interface, but also into the API available to write your own user interface. So as I say, it really depends. Most customers sort of use our user interface for the first tryouts, but then when they build their own vehicles and really then roll out their own vehicles, they integrate that into their own graphical user interface.
Why is user experience so important, Jörg?
Because the AGVs run in worldwide in very different locations, and sometimes it's difficult to get stuff, especially stuff that can operate and handle complex computer software. So it's necessary to get the local people in this environment to be able to use and change settings of the AGV and handle things locally.
Mm-hmm. You went on a new path of user experience. You used a game engine for your user interfaces. It's called Unity in Europe or in Germany. Why are you using a gaming engine to do that?
Because many people are used to this experience to be able to get a 3D representation of the environment, and people are very fast in understanding the situation in these kind of graphical representations, and it's a great community that provides a lot of tools and
it is open source or
No, it's not open source, but mm-hmm. It's a strong, very strong community
okay.
that can provide a lot of things almost for free,
mm-hmm.
and that helps us a lot. Yeah.
Okay. So, but it's not a gaming. When you look at the user interface, it's not a gaming world. But you took the main advantages from this gaming engine.
Yes, correct. We want to have it simple. We call one key feature is a one-click mapping.
Mm-hmm.
So only one button to operate the mapping process and to make it easy. Yeah?
Okay.
But it's a complex algorithm. It's a complex situation in these environments, huge areas which have to be covered, and to understand the setting and what the machine is doing. And the software is doing, it's necessary to have good representation.
So a normal worker can run the AGV with your locator and can design a map.
Yes, a shift yeah. leader that can operate yeah. a PC will be able to also to use our tool.
Okay. You published a version 1.1. What did you edit on this new version?
Yeah, so one big major sort of functionality we added was actually what we call reference alignment. This allows the user to scale the laser map to the real world. Mm-hmm. Imagine you have a very large warehouse with a very, very many storage areas. And the traditional way is actually then to teach every individual storage area to the AGV when you set it up. But by using our reference alignment, it is possible to scale our laser map to the real world. And then if, for instance, if you have a CAD map or architectural map of your environment, you can then lay these maps on top of each other, and it's much easier to, sort of integrate your AGV into an existing environment.
We have some questions, Jörg.
Yes, already questioned. There's the first one to Hyojin. I read it
yes.
for you.
Yes.
It's from Megasio. Is the high interest in China at the same level for cobots as for robotics?
Yes, I would think so. For example, for the cobots currently, there are also a lot of applications, not only in the industry sectors, but also in the big e-commerce warehouse, for example, for the dispatching fulfillment centers. That's why the currently cobots or AGVs are both the two biggest trends in China for the whole solution packages. And also there's a combination, mobile manipulators, that's cobot plus AGVs. So that's why these two are interacting a lot, and there are also a lot of local companies providing these services.
Yes, thank you. And there's a question to me
yeah.
from Michael. So I read it to you. How do you deal with the issue of copyright in the Chinese market? It's a very interesting question, and also something
political,
also technical, because our Chinese customers are very price sensitive. So they have or take out features, for example, in the hardware to be able to anchor our software product to. Yeah? And it can be political, but there's a standard like a TPM, Trusted Platform Module, that is going back and forth. And these issues and the solution with a dongle help us to be safe in this environment. So we provide a dongle solution, so the customer is flexible to move our software component from one hardware to another with the dongle, or we use a hardware trusted platform module to license our product.
But it's not only a Chinese problem, you have it all over the world, this topic.
It is all over the world, yes, correct. But in China, specifically, is that safety components or hardware components that might be usual in other countries will be taken out to reduce the price in hardware.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And maybe we have another challenge because our software runs on any hardware, so we cannot really control what it's not our own hardware. And the second is it's not always online. So those are two typical features where you can sort of license. That's why we came up with a different solution.
Mm-hmm. Let's come back to the distribution center. I ordered an AGV from company A, B, C, D. I have different AGVs in my distribution center because it was growing and some was cheaper and a good offer. Can I match these AGVs with your locator on one map, or can I use different AGVs?
Yes, it's very easy to use a fleet of AGVs.
Different fleet?
Yes, each okay. AGV has a client version of our locator product. And if the laser scanners on the same level, so we see the same map, this map can be exchanged with a server. So all vehicles in the fleet will have the same map. And this is especially helpful and useful with our map update function. Mm-hmm. So if an AGV is running in an area and there's a lot of changes in the environment, the warehouse is getting empty, for example, sometime, it's important to share this environment changes with all AGVs. So if another AGV comes into this area, it can be localized as well.
When I visit distribution centers, normally in Germany or in Europe, the warehouse management systems don't have APIs. It's closed systems. How is the bridge between the fleet service software and the warehouse management system?
Things are happening here in German, at least. The German Automobile Association is sort of pushing a standard, because this is exactly the issue, as you mentioned. They have several different kinds of vehicles, different manufacturers. They might even have manual vehicles sharing spaces with the automatic vehicles, and they, of course, want a coordinated system. And this is something the VDMA is pushing, and we are also closely following, and which we think is a good idea to get a standard here, so vehicles can talk to each other and also talk with a central management system.
Okay, so this is there's still a lot of work. Yeah.
Yeah. There's another question coming in. A question about the robustness of the localization. Mm-hmm. So how do you deal with disturbances like ramps? Mm-hmm. Christopher, maybe you can.
Yes, I mean, basically our system is 2D, so we can use the safety laser scanner, which I think is quite a nice feature. You don't need an additional scanner for the positioning. So basically our assumption is that we're in a flat world, but of course the reality is not flat. So we can handle ramps up to 6%. But if anything steeper than that, at least where the ramp areas are, we have problems with the localization. Because, of course, you can imagine going up or down the ramp, the laser will either see the floor or the sky. There we need to use different methods. For instance, also we can combine the wheel odometry. But then, as I say, that's a more special case you'd have to really look into. But we can handle several floors, for example. So if you have a warehouse on two floors with a ramp in between, we can have two maps, one for the lower level, one for the upper level. And we'd have to see what we can do in the middle.
I have a warehouse, two warehouses, and between the AGV has to drive outside, it's also no problem?
Basically, that's not a problem for our software. It just depends a little bit on your AGV. Mm-hmm. Is it outdoor suitable? Mm-hmm. And also, of course, the laser scanner. There are laser scanners that are usable for outdoor, for instance, with a heated screen, so they don't steam up in winter, and waterproof and things like that. But that's not really a problem either.
Do I need a special laser scanner, or can I use my laser scanner or the AGV?
Yeah, I mean, we support a whole range of laser scanners directly with our software. We also have a generic interface that allows the user to add his own laser scanner data, basically. Of course, you always need to have a little bit, or let's say the laser scanner needs to suit the environment. We just mentioned outdoor. If you want to drive outdoor, you need to have an outdoor laser. If you have very large distances, open spaces, you might need a laser scanner with a further reach. I have a small laser scanner for the demonstrations that just has a very short reach, but it's very small. I can use in my handbag. Yes. So you have to choose the laser for the environment. But in most cases, actually, you can use the laser scanner that you have on your AGV anyway for safety reasons, the safety laser scanner.
Okay. Jörg, how long do you need to map a brownfield or a distribution center? How?
Very easy. It's as long as it takes to drive with the vehicle, with the AGV, in the area you want to operate
it. So there's
If you have a manual forklift truck, and we also provide a locator for manual trucks, you
can
drive at 25 km/h.
Mm-hmm.
Or it's 1 meter per second, 2 meters per second, depending on the speed.
Okay. In Germany, there's a big rental market for forklifts. What is it about in China, Eugene? Is there a rental market for forklifts?
Yes, there's also this kind of leasing companies. They provide AGV solutions and they charge service fees. This is also common in China.
So I think, but in Germany, it's still not that you can rent or lease AGVs. But with your solution, it is much more easier to rent or to lease, to build a leasing business around AGVs, because you can implement mapping very fast. Is it a push for AGVs, for a rental market of AGVs?
Yes, definitely, because this benefits both the end users and also the leasing rental companies, because for the leasing rental companies, they need to put less efforts for the commissioning and also definitely less efforts for the service they have to provide to the end customers, because they definitely have a service level agreement assigned with the end customer. And also for the end customers, the CapEx now, capital expenditure will be definitely lower, and this is nowadays always a good solution for those plants who is very sensitive of fixed investment.
Okay. What about Germany and Europe, Jörg?
It's similar, yes. Mm-hmm. It's also established business and a very good business also for forklift OEMs, mm-hmm. to have this service, and for AGVs it's growing up. When you talk about AGVs or mobile robots, they're quite specific for design for a certain box, pallet, or environment. And this will be more standardized and become more standardized also with our component. And then it's easier also to exchange, mm-hmm. and redesign a warehouse or a shop floor. Yeah.
Let's talk one about the situation today. We have a lot of the big discussion about coming back to Europe. Supply chains are changing. Do you think that will be more warehouses, more automation in warehouses in the next coming 5 years?
Yes, I think so. Yes.
Smaller warehouses with highly automated.
Yes. Main targets are production, so production environments, and also warehousing for retail. And both is still a growing demand, yes.
Okay. So do you have any questions from the audience? So this is a chance to ask some questions.
Actually, there are two more questions.
Yeah.
Peter is asking, just in addition, is there a chance to test your software, or is there something like a test kit available?
Yes, so we do actually offer a test kit where we actually install the software already on a piece of hardware, so you don't even have to do that. So it comes already all set up on a small computer. You just need to hook up any laser scanner, and then you can test it very easily with our user interface we already offer. For the first test, that's what most customers actually do, because you just very quickly within, you know, sort of how long it takes you to drive around the warehouse, your own environment, you can see the first results.
And there's another question to Huajin.
Yes.
Michael asks, you talked about a customer Geek Plus in China. Are there already AGVs running with the Locator software? Are there other references customers in China?
Good question.
Yes, they are already licensed provided to Geek Plus, and they used in their internal testing and also in their pilot project. And also we have other customers already have our licenses in their pilot projects. I mean, commercial, really customer and customer projects. This includes AGVs. And also another branch is to use our locator for the autonomous forklifts, which is also a very high topics in China. Now a lot of e-warehouses and also industrial warehouses want to use this kind of, we call it in China AGV forklifts.
I've never heard that in Germany. AGV forklifts, autonomous forklifts. I've never heard that they're doing that in Europe or in Germany.
We don't really differentiate. Yeah. I mean, AGV is for us also automatic forklift, really.
Ah, okay. It's okay.
So it's very interesting in China. There's student groups that did RoboCup a few years ago and now doing AGV. Companies have money and they're very fast in decision, very fast in implementing things. And there's still a large growing number of AGV manufacturers. So it's difficult, I think, for Huajun to explain
to know
how
every
many
company
contacts he has, because it's always surprising every week new names coming up here. It's really, really very fast market.
But I want to say one sentence here. We as Bosch Rexroth is now really from the eyes of our end customers. We are, from one side, are reliable partners, industrialized partners, and also from the other side, we are agile and very flexible. And that's what they really appraise us a lot for our fast engaging.
Okay, thank you. Any more questions from the audience? Or we have 30 minutes already. If there are no other questions. If you want to watch this or to hear this, you can't watch it. You want to hear this podcast once again in the next days. It will be available on YouTube. And if you now want to talk to the experts, leave a small message now in the chat, and then you will be unmuted. Once again, now a message, and then after we will unmute you.